Computer and Information Sciences, Sucharita Parija. Monica Gupta. Monica Gupta. Monica Gupta. Then Mohammed Fajer. Next, from the School of Engineering and Technology, K. Gauri in BTCM program from Bhuvaneshwar. Sanjeev Saxena from PGDM Bhopal and R. Rajashekar, ADCM from Delhi. V. Narayanan, DCIM from Kochi. Ashok Kumar, DCLE, Dehradun. And Subhash Chand Sharma, DME, Bangalore. From the School of Sciences, Kalpana Tehlan, BSc from Delhi. Kalpana Tehlan, the BSc program from Delhi. Then Kriti Srivastav, PG Diploma in Environmental Sciences and Development, Bhopal. School of Vocational Education and Training, Neeta K. Thomas from Cochin. Manish Venugopal, ADAOM program from Cochin. Manish Venugopal. Next, Gaurav Sharma, PG diploma from Delhi. Ajay Prasad, PG DSO from Delhi. V Hema from Bangalore. S Vinay from Delhi. And Dinesh Kumar. Dinesh Kumar from Delhi.
One candidate from the School of Social Work has just arrived, Syed Shakil Ul Rahman. The university medals be awarded to them. First is Alia Hamid Ali for the Master of Arts in English from Jeddah. Kumari, Master of Arts Hindi from Ranchi. Amina Nuria Vayal Parambat, Bachelor of Arts from Riyadh. Arab centers are doing very well. Khushbu Kapoor for the PG Diploma in Audio Program Production from Jaipur. A Rakib K from Cochin in the PG Journalism and Mass Communication is not here. Thank you.
Sir, I present to you the meritorious candidates from the School of Health Sciences, School of Management Studies, School of Social Sciences, School of Translation Studies and Training, Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Award for the best performer in the Master's degrees, and Professor Grover's CASE Awards for the meritorious students with disabilities for the award of medals. I request that the university medals be awarded to them. School of Health Sciences, Vidya Vijay Kadam, BSc Nursing from Pune. Shashank Bhushan Singh, PG Diploma in Clinical Cardiology from Bhopal. Vishnu Chan Jambani, Postgraduate Diploma in Geriatric Medicine from Hyderabad. Dr. Veena Doda, Postgraduate Diploma in Hospital and Health Management from Delhi. Rashmi Mishra, Postgraduate Diploma in Maternal and Child Health from Delhi. Anjali Kausal, Diploma in Nursing Administration from Delhi. From the School of Management Studies, Pooja Sharma, MBA from Banking and Finance from Kanna. Viswaraj Bajacharya, PG Diploma in Financial Management from Nepal. R. Tilakavathi, PG Diploma in Human Resource Management from Chennai. Sneha Shahani, PG Diploma in International Business Operations from Hyderabad. Rakesh Singh, Diploma in Management from the Indian Army. Shreya Khatri, Diploma in Management from the Convergence Scheme. From the School of Social Sciences, Vasant Kumar, Master of Arts in History from Patna. Har Singh, Master of Library Science and Information and Library Science from Delhi. Sheetu Raina, Master of Arts, Public Administration from Jammu. Mandakini Kumari, Master of Arts, Political Science from Ranchi. Satnam Singh, Master of Arts, Sociology from Jammu. From the School of Translation Studies and Training, Ram Agarwal, PG Diploma in Translation from Delhi. Rama Agarwal. Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Medal for the highest aggregate marks in the Master's degree programs in Social Sciences. Satnam Singh, Master of Arts in Sociology from Jammu. Now, okay. Professor Grover Cash Award for the best among the meritorious students with disabilities. Mohammed Sadruddin, M.Com from Calcutta. Ashish Sharma, BSc from Delhi. Master of Arts in Sociology, Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Award.
Present to you the meritorious candidates from the School of Education for the award of medals. I request that the university medals be awarded to them. Shiv Kumar Jha for MA Education, and he is from Patna. for BA, three candidates have been awarded gold medals, and one is Divya Devi. She is not present. She is from Hyderabad. The second person is Ujjwal Grover from Lucknow. Third candidate who got gold medal in BA is Ruchi Mehta from Delhi. PG Diploma in Distance Education, Kiran is got, and she is from Delhi. Diploma in School Leadership and Management, Lata S. From Cochin has been awarded gold medal. Diploma in Primary Education, Raju Saw from Ranchi.
Sir, I present to you the meritorious candidates from the School of Engineering Education for the award of medals. I request that the university medals be awarded to them. First, Mr. Sandeep Kumar Pathak from Ranchi for MA in Rural Development. Next is Pratima Kumari for Postgraduate Diploma in Rural Development from Darbhanga. Sir, the two other candidates who also were awarded gold medal from the School of Continuing Education and could not be here physically are Dana Lakshmi for Diploma in Early Childhood Care and Education and Chanchal Jaggi for Diploma in Nutrition and Health Education from Khanna. We congratulate them. Thank you, sir.
Sir, I present to you the meritorious candidates from the School of Interdisciplinary and Transdisciplinary Studies for the award of medal. I request that the university medal be awarded to them. Mr. Ramesh Kumar, MSc of Integrated MSc PhD in Physics and Astrophysics from Lucknow. Shefalika Bose from other PGDFCS from Delhi.
Sir, I present to you the recipient of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Cash Award of Rs. 10,000 for the Gold Medalist in Bachelor of Social Work. This award was instituted by Dr. Abdul Kalam when he delivered the Mother Teresa Memorial Lecture here in the university about 3 years ago. Dr. Shaila Ali.
Sir, I present to you the SIMCA Cash Award winner for Rs. 10,000 for the best female student in the program related to information and communication technology, Madam Sucharita Parija of the Masters in Computer Applications from Bhuvaneshwar. Sucharita Parija.
I present to you for award of Best Regional Center Award for Regional Centers and Best Partner Institutes under Convergence Scheme. Best Regional Center, Cochin. Shillong. Under Convergence Scheme, Government Postgraduate College, Pratapgarh, Rajasthan. Institute in Northeast region under Convergence Scheme, Government Degree College, Amarpur, Tripura.
you, sir.
IGNU has reached about 40 countries through 67 collaborators and partner institutions. These partner institutions are the face of IGNU in the global knowledge communities. This year, IGNU considered 6 partner institutions for the award of gold medal for the best PI. Nevertheless, all 6 partner institutions had performed extraordinarily well in terms of student strength, learning support, and examination performance. As is evident by 7 gold medals awarded to them, sir, I have the privilege to invite International Center of Academics, Kathmandu, Nepal, to receive the gold medal for Best Partner Institution for 2010-11. Mr. Biswajit Mukherjee, Coordinator, ICA, please. IGNU will also like to put on record an appreciation due to Educational Consulting Guidance Services, Saudi Arabia, for their appreciable and amicable services rendered to IGNU students from Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. The partner institution has been consecutively receiving gold medals for their students, especially in MA English, 5 times in a row without even breaking the track record even this time. To recognize the services of ECGS IGNU, would like to give a certificate of appreciation to them. May I invite Mr. Riaz Mullah to receive the certificate, please.
University has instituted gold medal for the best innovation, and this award is restricted to the members of staff at IGNU, and I have the privilege to announce the name of the winners. This time the award goes jointly, first to Dr. Harkirat Bains, Director in Charge of School of Tourism Hospitality Services Sectoral Management IGNU, for her work related to designing, structuring and preparing the Anganwadi workers training program, which had created tremendous impact in the state of Madhya Pradesh, who have recognized this program. And also the co-workers, Dr. Lalita S. Kumar and Dr. Sanjeev Kumar of School of Sciences IGNU, for effectively and judiciously using Vedadhara Technology Enhanced Open Learning System for the Postgraduate Diploma in Analytical Chemistry program. I request that the gold medal be awarded to them. University has also instituted gold medal for the best community college, and the award goes to Mitraniketan People's College, Velanad, Thiruvananthapuram. Of course, the representative from the said college is absent. Thank you.
Sir, I present to you for the award of Indian Bank sponsored medals to the best research paper and second best research paper. I request that these medals be awarded to them. The gold medal goes to Dr. Neeta Madhur, Associate Professor, Sociology Discipline, School of Social Sciences. On the topic, shopping malls, credit cards and global brands, consumer culture and lifestyle of India's middle class. For the second best, silver medal goes to Dr. Maumita Das, Assistant Director, National Center for Innovation in Distance Education. On the topic, Science Lab Practicals in Distance Education, the need for innovative solutions.
Please listen to the convocation address of Honorable Human Resource Development Minister Sri Kapil Sibal ji.
Vice Chancellor of IGNU, Professor Rajshekharan Pillai, Pro Vice Chancellors, members of the Board of Management, Academic Council and Planning Board, directors of schools, heads of divisions, distinguished faculty members, staff, graduating students and their families, and friends, and of course, representatives of the media, ladies and gentlemen. Dear graduates, those of you who are present here and the overwhelming majority who are unable to be with us, you're all graduating at a time when India is on a very impressive growth path, despite international economic vicissitudes. The Indian economy is booming. Never before was there a time like the present when things looked so good. Our foreign exchange reserves are over $300 billion. And if the global situation does not go awry, we should even be clocking a double-digit GDP growth over the next decade. We have a most favorable demographic profile, with 50% of the population below the median age of 25. Yes, India will remain young, at least over your working life. Thus, opportunities are very many and the avenues are open for you to explore and benefit from these. We all recognize that education has proven to be a remarkably effective catalyst for social development and economic growth in all countries. So it is in some sense not only the individual who is empowered by education, but it is in the broader sense, the community and the society. Each additional year of education translates into an increase in an individual's earning potential. Wages of educated workers are higher, as are earnings of small business owners and farmers who are inspired to take advantage of new technologies. Thus, central to improving our country's well-being is the overall improvement of our education system. I was delighted to see the census figures that were announced yesterday, to find that our literacy rate has moved from 64.8% to 74.4%, and the female literacy rate increased from 53% to 65%, whereas male literacy increased from 75% to 82%. This is extremely heartening because it tells us that more and more parents, more and more families are interested in educating their children, especially the girl child, because the jump in the female literacy rate of 12% indicates that our women are out there and going to be part of our workforce, and that families with educated women will ensure that their children for future generations will be educated. That augurs very well for India. But there is a concern that I have that despite these numbers, we need much greater access to education. The figures also suggest that there are about 8 million children out of school. This is a matter of great concern for us. If you look at the gross enrollment ratio in India, it is around 13-14%. In other words, children in the age group of 18 to 24, of every 100 children, only 13 to 14 reach college. Now, in any developed country, that percentage is over 50, in some cases 70 out of every 100. That's the difference between developing nations and the developed world. We must commit ourselves to increase the gross enrollment ratio from 13 to at least 30. And I have committed that by the year 2020, we will achieve that. But what that means is that if we are able to achieve that figure and have the gross enrollment ratio rise from 13 to 30, we will have 40 to 45 million children going to college instead of 14 million children today. And the 14 million children today are served by about 26,000-27,000 colleges and about 600-700 universities, which means for the extra 30 odd million children, when the numbers increase to 45 million, we will need another 1,000 universities in the next 10 years and another 40,000-45,000 colleges. That's a tall order. To build infrastructure for 45,000 colleges and about 1,000 universities is no easy job, and of course this cannot be done overnight. So we need to do something drastic. We need to do something quickly. We need to ensure access to education for a vast majority of our children, but at the same time we need to ensure that access provides quality education for our children. And because we will not be able to build that infrastructure very quickly in the next few years, or there will be a time lag between building that infrastructure which will not be able to meet the which will not be able to deliver the absorption capacity of the increasing number of children going to college, we will ultimately rely on institutions like IGNO. The answer lies in distance education. It is becoming increasingly popular as economic forces encourage and new technologies facilitate its spread. The convergence of communications and computing technologies is rewriting the possibilities for distance education, both in terms of capabilities and costs. Distance education has become popular because it offers people from rural working class communities access to higher education. We are thus targeting an enrollment of at least 7 million students, with a majority from the disadvantaged sections and locations, during the next few years. Also, online courses are facilitating universities to reach out to students who have been traditionally unable, for a variety of reasons, to enroll in classes on campus. Several universities are expanding their online education programs because these offer improved student access to education and at the same time overcome limited classroom space, instructor shortages and conflicting course schedules. Similarly, in taking an online course, students have the ability to study and complete assignments at their own pace. Admittedly, online education has the potential to enfranchise previously disenfranchised students, such as non-traditional students, minority students, and students with limited incomes, but it also bears great responsibility for ensuring that the students are truly empowered through legitimate quality education. Open and distance learning is therefore recognized as an accepted mode, providing a framework outside the formal system. But access alone cannot be an objective in the context of our public pronouncement that expansion, as I said, inclusion and excellence are the three necessary pillars to impart quality education. That open and distant learning must, apart from access, also provide quality education, not just in the matter of academic material, but also in the field of skill development. Education is not just absorption of knowledge, it is important to create an environment and a framework through which acquisition of knowledge and skills go hand in hand, thus empowering our young men and women to use that knowledge for productive activities. If we allow distance education to be used as an effective and alternative tool to formal education, the horizons of distance education and open educational resources will expand exponentially. But as you know, distance education requires the use of technology, and technology will ultimately be the vehicle through which distance education will reach the unempowered masses of India, also adults who want access to distance education. And therefore our government has a program in the next few years to connect every village with broadband facility, to ensure that there is enough capacity for the flow of data to those who need it most and who require it most. We can also, in fact, use this technology to simulate laboratory experiments for students who need to do these experiments but don't have the necessary wherewithal and the equipment in the institutions in which they study. We have the technology, in fact, to create virtual labs to allow our young students to obtain hands-on experience for technical training and skill development. We need to invest much more in these technologies and develop new teaching methodologies which will enable us access to complex educational resources necessary for enhancing excellence in the field of distance education. The absence of faculty, both at the tertiary level, can well be compensated not only through distance learning programs but also through interactive teaching where technology is an appropriate enabler. I might add that distance learning and open educational resources are not just about earning degrees or diplomas through certification courses, but can and must cater to a large variety of inputs to those who need them for earning their livelihood. But we also must ensure that the quality of this distance education in terms of the software is of a standard that will give the kind of benefits that are required to be accessed. And therefore, it's very important on the software side for individuals with high academic credentials to prepare those software, through software, those course materials which are of such a quality that you don't necessarily feel the physical absence of a teacher. And so therefore, those open educational resources have to be of great quality. Distance education can also ensure that preventive healthcare measures can be taken through dissemination, by dissemination through distance learning, and data for symptoms and early warning of diseases can be accessed in this mode. Skilled workers can enhance their skills, and those unskilled can acquire skills through distance learning. New languages can be learnt, new methodologies adopted, all directed not just to the acquisition of knowledge, but also directly related to livelihood. The linkage between learning and livelihood can best be provided through distance education. Because of the peculiar socio-economic milieu in which our disadvantaged groups and women survive, it may not be possible for them to have access to formal schooling. Distance learning allows the consumer of knowledge to have access to it without having to go to school. Methodologies must be developed to allow access to such consumers of knowledge who, without giving up their employment, need to acquire and enhance their skills. Consumers of knowledge may wish to acquire multiple skills without having to go to campuses of universities. This also can be provided through distance education and open education resources. At the heart of such an enterprise is the need of connectivity through broadband, as I mentioned earlier. The true choices available through distance learning will only come about if we are able to build the necessary infrastructure for connectivity. However, we have come to a pass where distance education, instead of serving the noble purpose of delivering low-cost quality education to those unable to access education, has become a fertile ground for fly-by-night operators, for exploitation of students. We've been deeply concerned at this growing malaise. I have constituted a committee to suggest measures to regulate the standards of education through distance mode in the country. These measures should not be intrusive and prohibitive, but be able to finally discriminate between the good and the bad providers and prevent students from exploitation. Dear graduates, the country needs young people like you who are willing to take on the responsibility of hard work to make India a still better place for all of us. For it is in times like these when there is turmoil in many parts of the country, when there is tremendous inequity among our people, when the challenges seem truly insurmountable, it's tempting to plead helplessness and ask oneself, what can one person possibly do? My belief, and this is born out of my personal experience, is that you can do a lot. Today I want to encourage you also to believe, as I do, in the power of the self. You are one person, but you have many talents, many gifts that you can use to build a career, family, a life, and more importantly, mold our society and the world around you. My own belief is that each of us must take responsibility for the management, governance, and improvement of our society. If we leave this mission only to elected politicians like me, that may lead you in directions that compromise your cherished principles. In other words, what's the use of a dream if it doesn't emerge from yourself? Have a worthy dream and translate it to reality by your own actions. I also sincerely believe that an intelligent person can do just about anything. Yes, there are only some activities at which one of us can excel, but I assure you that there are hundreds of others at which each one of us can be very, very good. And there are only very few activities in which our results will be poor as long as we make a genuine effort. So don't wait for the perfect job to come your way. You will do well in whatever you set your mind to take up. Young minds like you who are graduating today have a great responsibility on your shoulders. I would like all of you to see yourselves as agents of change for a new India. The goal of capturing knowledge leadership for India is realizable in your lifetime. You are graduating at the most appropriate time for shaping such a knowledge-driven India. You can make that dream a reality. You can be leaders in a knowledge-driven new India. To achieve this, you have to follow a few simple but profound principles. That is, never compromise on excellence, never give up, and convert every adversity into an opportunity. Friends, let me assure you that it is a great time to be in India. Even more, it is a great time to be in India. Enjoy being part of the action in a country with a proud past and destined for a great future. So good luck in shaping the world and your life for tomorrow. Tomorrow is a new day and a new life awaits you. Once again, I congratulate the graduating class of year 2011. Be the role models to millions of our youth and convey to them, through your successes and triumphs, the potential of open and distance education. I would have loved to be in person with you today to deliver this address. I am sorry that I have not been able to be with you today, but my best wishes are with you. Good luck. Jai Hind.
The Honorable Minister will also be launching the online edition of the open letter, the official newsletter of Indira Gandhi National Open University. Following that, he will be launching the Techno Inter Online Teach Program, Empowering Educators to Innovate, an initiative by Sir C.V. Raman, Chair for Science Education of Indira Gandhi National Open University, coordinated by none other than Professor P.T. Manoharan, the Chief Guest of today. Thank you.
On this 22nd convocation occasion, I'm happy to launch the online edition of the open letter, the official newsletter of IGNU. I'm also happy to launch the IGNU Intel online teach program, Empowering Educators to Innovate, an initiative by the Sir C.V. Raman Chair of Science Education of IGNU, coordinated by Professor P.T. Manoharan. Thank you.